Okay, extremely busy day in an extremely busy country on an extremely busy planet and in a very busy world of humans and others who are struggling to get along and survive. Hello, Webster Griffin Tarpley. How are you?
Hello, Jeff. We reached the midpoint of the year, practically.
It's unbelievable,
right?
Isn't it?
It's done by fast.
Yeah, it has. All right, let's jump. Go.
I suggested a series of things we might talk about.
Sure.
Let me start with some good news. Let's start with something good.
What was that? Good news?
Good news, yeah. Good. In the European parliamentary election, about two weeks ago now.
Yeah.
There was one extremely important development, which was in the different countries. Of course, each of the outcome of the European Parliament has an immediate impact on the situation in each European country. And the most important single thing is that Alexis Tsipras of the Syriza left-wing bloc or confederation of parties has now emerged as the biggest party in Greece. This is the first time this has ever happened in modern history, I think ever. And this is a party, as I hope people know, which is militantly anti-austerity. No cuts, no genocide, no destruction of the social safety net. Rehire all the people that have been fired. And he wants a new deal. His basic approach is, have a European or indeed world debt conference, similar to the London conference of the early 1950s. You remember that one wrote down the debt of Germany, right? Defeated Germany after World War II. So he suggests cutting 40, 50, 60% off existing European debt. This would be a haircut with the guillotine for certain bankers. They really deserve exactly this. And then he says, once you've freed these economies of this crushing debt burden, which they have to pay in dollars, right? That's why this is such a hard thing for them. Then a new deal, and that means heavy-duty infrastructure investments, right? Reindustrialization, human development, education, healthcare, and all sorts of
things. He better have
things.
Somebody else start his car for a while. This guy is too good.
Yes. And here's what I am not able to state this as absolute fact, but the word is that Tsipras was thinking, and his group, what might NATO do to us? In other words, if you defy the International Monetary Fund and the European Central Bank and the European Commission.
Look at Saddam Hussein. Look what happened to Muammar Gaddafi.
Yes.
Come on.
Although this is, I would also point out there's an element of moderation and of prudence in this, which I think is extremely important. Notice that he doesn't say down with the euro. He is for working inside the euro, which I think is the absolute right thing to do. Mm-hmm. The people who are against the euro, we see it more and more, are either the racists and neo-fascists or ultra-lefts, right? Some kind of Maoist regurgitation. So
where did this guy come from?
He's from the Communist Party, KKE Youth Group. And what he did was then to assemble 10, 12 different organizations, parties, sects, sectlets, groups, groupuscules, you name it. And he got them together. That's the really important thing. He was at 4% in early 2012, and he is now about 30%. And the trick is, in Greece, of course, you have this majority bonus. In other words, whoever crosses the finish line first, right, whoever gets the largest sum of votes in the country gets an extra 20 or 30% of the parliament. So it's not going to be a situation not being able to have a majority, even though you're the biggest party.
You used a word I've never heard before. You do that sometimes. It's a great word. See if I can pronounce it so people can understand it. You said, and it went by real fast, sectlets.
Sectlets, yeah. There's a vocabulary for all of the different tiny splinter groups.
That's good.
That emerge, right?
What was really good is that you said it so well. You pronounced it perfectly.
How about groupuscules? That's sort of the same idea. So, right. This comes from the left wing world of Europe, right, in which I used to operate for quite a number of years. But now look, when they have a parliamentary election, it's going to be Tsipras as prime minister. Now, he has mocked Merkel as the sleepwalker of Europe, right? Sonambula, the opera by Bellini, you probably
that's good.
Know it.
The zombie.
So imagine when we have the Council of Ministers of the European Union, and you have Merkel sitting there, and then you have Tsipras sitting there. This is going to fundamentally change the world. And I tried to point out, he's looked ahead to what NATO might try to do, the countermoves. Obviously, personal security, as you suggest, is right at the top of the list. But it's very easy, for example, for NATO to arrange to use the Turkish army to try to crush something in Greece. Say, this would be the way the Allies used the Romanian army after World War I to crush the Bela Kun regime in Hungary or something like this. So what you do is you take a place where there's already a national conflict, right, of a deeply rooted ethnic estrangement, right? So Turks and Greeks obviously don't get along. So all you need to do is gin up some kind of an incident in Cyprus, in the Aegean, on one of these islands, drilling in the Aegean seafloor, whatever it is, and you could use then the Turkish army to invade Greece.
Yeah.
However, what Tsipras has done is go to Putin as an insurance policy, saying, look, Putin, if Turkey attacks me, I want your help. And I think this is helped along by, you know, the Orthodox cultural world and other kinds of traditional elements. So I would take this very, very seriously. But this is really important, right? And this is, you're not going to read about this because they don't want you to know.
That's
very interesting. You look at these people like Farage of the UK Independence Party, in my view, a scoundrel. You look at Marine Le Pen. She's the talentless, the nepotistic daughter of the elder Le Pen, my Jean-Marie Le Pen. He's a Vichy fascist. He comes from the Marshal Pétain group, allied with Hitler. Then you look at some others. Look at Grillo of Italy, right? In the case of all these are not fundamentally opponents of the bankers' domination and the central banks and so forth. They're not feared by bankers. You don't see bankers, you know, screaming for them to be, you know, eliminated and so forth. And that is the idea, simply this, that when you get into a crisis, we have to remember these are the first European elections since the Depression began in grand style, right? The last one was in 2009, and this was so before the full political and economic effect of the current world economic depression had been felt. But now we're feeling it. So this is what you see. So the bankers are eager to scapegoat Pakistanis and West Indians in Britain, Algerians in France, Somalis and Moroccans in Italy, or whatever it is. They're eager to have right-wing, racist, neo-fascist, populist types come in because this is a way of deflecting the rage of the masses away from the bankers, obviously enough, right? And I've always said, one of my political mottos, if you're not fighting bankers, you're spinning your wheels. You're wasting your time, and you're probably cutting your own throat.
Good title for your next book.
And then we have Grillo, right? This also, I thought, was very, very interesting. Grillo is this demagogic monster of Italy. I have to use the word monster carefully because Tsipras has said that Farage of Great Britain is a monstrosity created because of the effects of austerity and depression in the European economies. But I would also add that Grillo, in terms of what he looks like, if anything, is even more of a monster. Now, you got to remember, Grillo has been endorsed by the State Department. We have the texts of State Department cables where they say this is somebody that we can use. We have insider testimony from a member of the Italian P2 Lodge saying the U.S. plan is to destroy Europe and destroy the euro, and Grillo is a useful tool in this. We've also got open public endorsement of Grillo by Goldman Sachs. The guy in Goldman Sachs, sure, The guy who coined the term pigs, Portugal, Ireland, Italy, Greece, yeah, yeah. and Spain, he came out endorsing Grillo last February, when a year ago February, when he first got a lot of votes. Now, Grillo had gotten 25% of the votes in the last national election. And he's, in the meantime, he has not produced anything. He has not done a damn thing for people who are in trouble. And this is something that anybody can see. The current Italian Prime Minister, Renzi, got 40% of the vote this time mm-hmm. because he had the sense to do something for people. And this was little enough, God knows. Tokenism, or a shock, we might say. Mm-hmm. 80 euros for every Italian, right? $100, $110. You will remember, though, that Bush did this with the Congress not so many years ago. We had this here. Remember they had an emergency tax cut as a stimulus in 07, 08, as I recall, and they sent out an immediate 100 or 150 per person? Remember that? It's not
something
so strange.
Like that. Yeah, yeah.
Anyway, Renzi...
Renzi is a relative of mine, so be careful.
Is he really? Renzi, oh, yeah. Unfortunately, is a creature of...
Well, no family's perfect. We all have a black sheep.
But the interesting thing is that Renzi is a rather restrained and not chaotic, anarchistic, or openly fascist.
Sounds
he
like
has
me.
Very bad economics, but he's not an open fascist in the way that Grillo mm-hmm. is, I would say. Grillo is anti-foreigner. He wants being an undocumented alien to remain as a crime. He tries to compete for racist votes. Mm-hmm. But here's the thing. Grillo ran saying, I'm going to win everything. And they'd ask him, what percent are you going to get? And he says, I'm already at 95%. What coalitions
95?
Will you found? Yeah, he's lying, of course.
I just sent you his picture. He looks like Opera Bouffe.
He looks, you can see why any voter would be frightened. But the thing that
he's
really
crazy
frightened him
looking.
Was,
yeah.
He began saying that the unions are the red plague, says Grillo. And he went to a town a bit north of Rome where there's a labor struggle going on. And he essentially intervened as a strike breaker and as an anti-union ideologue, right? In the same way that a fascist would of course, do, right? Which that was the hallmark of Hitler and Mussolini, was union busting. And then they asked him, what's your perspective, right? You know, you're being criticized. And his quote was, Grillo says, Grillo is beyond Hitler. Beyond Hitler. So that scared a lot of people.
See.
So, net result, he got 25% in February 2013. Mm-hmm. This time he was down to 20% or a little bit more, 21% so.
Beppe's and fortunes are diminishing.
Diminishing. And I think this is like Hitler. This is similar to Hitler in November of 1932. The first time he began to lose, the party began to fall apart. Now, Hitler was saved by a coup which put him into power as dictator. Otherwise, the movement would have, I think, collapsed of its own weight. I don't think it's possible for NATO to have a coup to install Grillo, although I think they would like to. Grillo still says that he wants to have an anti-Euro referendum. Just holding that, I think, would be an invitation to a very serious economic panic. But what Grillo has done is to act out, we can say, an alliance with Farage. Farage had been unwilling to deal with Le Pen, of the French racist, because, of course, as a British racist, Farage has got to pretend to be, against the WOGs. You know the WOGs, Jeff, right?
Yeah.
WOGs begin at Calais, right?
Yeah, yeah.
It means foreigners.
Who,
so
yes.
He didn't want to deal with the WOGs, but now Farage, for some reason, is willing to deal with Grillo, even though he's a WOG. And for Grillo, it's a way to get some status. So he's down from 25% to 21%, and he's above all humiliated because he had shot his mouth off. The main Italian newspaper, Corriere della Sera, gave a kind of a series of film clips mm-hmm. of all the times he said he would come in first. He would defeat everybody. He would not need a coalition. And they were getting ready to demand the resignation of the President of the Republic, the resignation of the Prime Minister. Mm-hmm. Some of these resignations would be fine with me, but
kinda
not
like
if
Obama's
it means
lies.
Grillo.
They strung them all together. He does look a little nutty. All right, let's go back
Grillo. He's a madman.
Yeah, well, he looks
He's a megalomaniac.
I just sent you the picture. Look at his eyes. All right,
I got other things that I have
Le Pen and
Hollande. Yeah, Le Pen is a sad case.
All right. Who would you pick? Who would you rather sit with?
I don't want to pick any of them. I picked
Hollande,
Tsipras, I told you.
Hollande or Pen?
Tsipras.
All right.
Okay.
All right.
We're not going to be forced to pick between Nazis and fascists or anything of the sort.
I thought I'd put you on the spot, but go ahead.
No, I can't even see it. I don't have it set up. Okay? So this is, I think that's important. So the idea is that Greece is going to blow a hole in this lockstep for killer austerity. And that, I think, will also be down here in the United States. That could precipitate some very dramatic events. If the ruling class is reasonable, they can come out quite well. But if they insist on the full neoliberal IMF shock therapy, horrendous killer austerity, then Tsipras and Syriza will fight back, and then they will find that they're in a dire crisis. And the reason this is important for us, we here, any kind of class-based, reasonable force here in the United States is, of course, weak at the present time.
Yeah.
So we need the efforts of places where, in Greece, because of the tremendous attack on the country and the living standard by the hedge funds and the central banks and Wall Street and the City of London, Greece has had a fall in its living standard, which is much more dramatic even than that.
Well,
the one we've had here. Plus, they're traditionally more politicized. They have a tradition of a strong communist party and all the rest. The communism is pretty much gone, but the idea of having a party is there. And that, of course, is important because otherwise you get people like Occupy coming to town, and they'll tell you, no party, no demands, no leader, no organization, no strategy, no nothing. Go camp in the park. And, of course, that's a recipe for absolute defeat. So there's some good news, wouldn't you say?
Sounds interesting, positive. I'd say Tsipras has a chance to do something, at least if he gets some press, that will help germinate other areas, maybe.
Why don't you get one of his spokespeople on?
Well, let's...
You should try
it. Do you have a contact? Let's do it.
It's that easy with these guys, because they're a lot of good people, but a lot
of... Are you fluent in Greek also?
No. Right. And especially not modern Greek.
Beppe must speak English because he had lunch with Farage, so...
Yeah.
All right, Beppe, we'll see if we can get an invitation.
Beppe talks out of both sides of his mouth.
Maybe he... Maybe he's got a Facebook page. I don't do Facebook. Beppe, Beppe Grillo, Grillo.
That's short for Giuseppe, right? Beppe Giuseppe.
Gotcha. Well, maybe somebody's got his Facebook page and can let me know, and I'll write him a letter. You write him a letter.
But no, not him. We don't need him. We need Tsipras. The hell with him.
I'd take either one. But seriously, Tsipras would be very good. Very interesting.
Absolutely good.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Next.
Or anybody from that Syriza group, because these are the lessons that must be learned, and this is the reality that must be understood. So most of the world press coverage was right wing racist gain in European election. Farage, Le Pen. There's also something here. Here's another one. Alternatives for Germany, right? Alternative für Deutschland.
Mm-hmm.
This is a pathetic group of legal cranks, pedants, petty bourgeois. And their whole story is, we hate the euro, we want our money, 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 because they have the idea that they're rich.
Well, they want
Germany,
Deutsche Marks back.
And this simply cannot be done. As Helmut Schmidt, the distinguished, this is somebody who at least speaks with the authority of long experience, right? Still alive, even though he smokes cigarettes all the time. I don't know how he does it.
Yeah, I've seen him
but
on video.
Helmut Schmidt has pointed out, if you were to go back to the German mark, today, in the age of derivatives, which were not around when the German mark was on the scene, with the help of credit default swaps in particular, but other kinds of derivative instruments, it's possible to organize speculative campaigns that were simply technically unthinkable in the pre-derivatives era. So if you had the German mark alone, the zombie banks and the hedge fund hyenas would drive that up into intergalactic space, and it would effectively destroy all German imports. And if you ever went back to something like the lira or the drachma or the peseta or something like that, even the French franc, those would be driven to the center of the earth. So there you would have hyperinflation in those countries, And in Germany, you would have hyper deflation, right? With this, you know, if you borrowed a mark, if you borrowed a euro and you had to pay that back, you'd be paying back, you know, hundreds or thousands of millions
back
of
to the
euros in the equivalent.
But so they could sell Weimar wheelbarrows again.
That would be in the southern European areas.
Now that was clever. Give me a
in Germany, it would have to be the other way around. In other words, you'd be coming with one mark would buy you a house, or you could buy a whole city block for 1 euro. So this you want to avoid. Yeah, and this is very important to understand. This is one of the reasons why you can't go home again. And the idea to return to these, the individual national currencies of essentially petty states, right? What can Luxembourg or Belgium represent in today's world? It's simply impossible. Or Slovakia, so many members of the European Union, apart from the Big Four, right, are all more or less impotent on the world stage. So anyway, the point is Tsipras.
They're impudent as well. All right, we have to take a break. We've got Putin, Siloviki. And neoliberals next. Then we got Jessica Matthews and Anne-Marie
Nebraska
Slaughter.
Nebraska Senate. Let's do the Nebraska Senate first, because I really want to talk about that.
All
and
right.
We have time to expatiate on the other.
We got all kinds of things tonight. We should. All right. Back in a flash. Hold on. Okay, back with Webster. All right, let's see if we can do this in a half an hour.
Let's try to knock off a series of items, okay? Let me do an item. I'll keep it short, and then you can comment, and then we move on, okay?
All right, Nebraska
Here's the
Senate.
First one, the Nebraska Senate race. This is shaping up as being highly, highly interesting. The Republican candidate is Ben Sasse.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Jeff, remember, last time around in 2008, we figured in the first week of January that Obama was the main Manchurian candidate of the ruling class.
We
right?
absolutely nailed it. Yep.
That was between Iowa and New Hampshire.
Yep, exactly.
Now it's 2.5 years before the vote, and we may have the person this time around.
It's
Ben Sasse.
Ben Sasse.
Ben Sasse of Nebraska. A couple of things about him. He's a good old boy from the Tea Party, but he says at one point in his career as a spook, which is what he was the interface of CIA and CIA, FBI, and Department of Justice. Now, that would make you a fairly high-level spook. He was also the number two or number three in the Health and Human Services under the Mormon Mike Leavitt, the former governor of Utah, who was up to his neck in all of that corruption that Mitt Romney cleaned up. And now, here's the story of Ben Sasse. Two very, very disturbing things. The profile is obviously, standard reactionary. Even though he's a liberal Republican, right? He's a Rockefeller type, Yale, Harvard, I guess, or some combination, Oxford too, I think.
Years ago, he bragged he was going to be the president.
Yes, and I want to thank you for putting up the that essay by Wayne Madsen. Wayne has latched onto this story, and I think he may be able to follow it even further down the line. I certainly
Agreed.
Hope so, because people need to know this.
Oh, this guy's a player. No question.
The idea is that Sasse is Tea Party and Country Club, so he can wrap up the Republicans. And remember how they do it, right? They get somebody who comes out of some unexpected quarter, a black president, a Jimmy Carter, a southern governor, right? So what haven't they done lately? They might do the woman. On the other hand, to do the woman after the black is perhaps somewhat obvious. You could do a Hispanic. Heartland. You could do somebody with deep roots in the Midwestern farmland and Heartland, and you could do that, and that would be Sasse. Now, specifically, in his career curriculum vitae, he tells us that he got an M.A. at St. John's of Annapolis here in Maryland. Now, that's interesting in itself, because those are the Leo Strauss neocons, right? That's the great books. And an M.A. from St. John's of Annapolis puts you in a somewhat special category. In other words, as a thinker, you may already be a neocon. But he said, during those years, 96, 97, 98, I would guess, he was the proctor and tutor of the House Pages. The House of Representatives Pages.
Now, that I missed. That's
so this, of course, we have to look back to Mark Foley. The revelations about Mark Foley, congressman, Republican congressman from Florida, molesting the pages. This was the story, really, for many people of 2006. Many people
he
would
was,
say
he was running the meat for the pedophile machine.
Quite possibly. The story in 2006 is not, for many people, many Republican voters anyway. Bush was not decisive. The Iraq War was not decisive. What was decisive was Mark Foley, the pedophile or molester, and this other guy, Jim Colby, and some others, and going after these young pages. Now, this means that Ben Sasse has a very serious PageGate problem, because he was one of four people, the proctors, whose specific duty it was to protect the pages. This is in loco parentis. This is that if they're away from home, they've got to be taken care of, because they're high school kids.
Sure.
And they live in a dormitory, and they've got to be taken care of. They also have educational responsibilities. In other words, they've got to keep going to school so they don't fall behind in their studies. So Ben Sasse is going to have to answer, what were you doing in 96, 97, 98, when we know from other sources that Mark Foley had already begun his nefarious activities in regard to the pages, right? This is already documented. What were you doing, Ben Sasse, to defend and protect those kids who were in your care? And it's made more complicated by the fact that Sasse then went on to become, in recent years, the president of Midland University, where we've just had the explosion of a sex scandal, which has forced the principal coach, right, the athletic director, to quit. It's like a Jerry Sandusky story, or a similar, occurring on Ben Sasse's watch when he's at the Midland University.
Well, there are a lot of pages who potentially could blow the whistle on this guy.
They could, and now there's even, of course, you have to remember, what's the scene of all this, right? 20 years ago, if you said Nebraska or Omaha, you didn't think of any wholesome, corn harvest, but you thought of the Larry King, Franklin Savings and Loan, pedophile charges, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the huge scandal
that
developed around that. So I think Ben Sasse will have some important explaining to do. And in that process, his ability to dupe the evangelical Christians of Nebraska, I think, is going to be seriously called into question. And then the other guy is Domina. Domina is a kind of a labor lawyer for the Democrats. But the one that interests me, of course, is the Tax Wall Street Party candidate. That's Dan Burdorf. He's running on a Wall Street sales tax, 1% Wall Street sales tax, parity, agriculture, back to 100% of parity.
That's the Tarpley tax.
It's the Wall Street sales tax.
I know.
Tax,
you were the first guy to talk about it.
No, I'm not. Tobin and even Keynes talks about it. Lord Keynes. It's one thing that even a Keynesian should be able to accept. And then this question of seizing the Fed, right? Forcing the Fed to at least open up a window where long-term low-interest credit for production, agriculture, and infrastructure.
Well, there's another guy who better have somebody else starting his car for him. Yeah, these guys are doing the right thing.
Anyway, it's called Dan for Nebraska. Dan for Nebraska.
All right.
Look that up. And
we're going to a break here in just a minute. For you folks who haven't heard the name, Benjamin E. Sasse, spelled S-A-S-S-E. Remember that, and look at his picture, watch his mannerisms, and understand this man was literally in charge of, I don't know how many pages there are, but
that program has been abolished, thanks to his nonfeasance and malfeasance. The program is over on the House side. The Senate still has it, but for the House, it's gone.
Wow. Well, there are hundreds of them. Okay, this is all interesting. He does have a history of speaking rather confidently about his ultimate future in this country. So we will see, as they say. You're right. They come out of nowhere. All of a sudden.
But this time we may have them 2.5 years before the vote.
Yeah, this would be a record for us. Hold on. Back in the flash. Okay, back with Webster. Just for a kick, here's a little bit of the sound of sass.
Don't sass me.
Don't sass me. There's an old song about that, isn't there? Here we go.
I think.
A candidate who just won Nebraska's GOP Senate primary this week. Joining me right now for his first cable news interview since claiming victory is Ben Sass. Congratulations, Ben. And I know you must be, everything must be in a whirlwind right now. But before we talk to his candidacy and chances of keeping that Senate seat Republican, I want to talk to you first about these new emails that have come to light, thanks to the Freedom of Information Watch and Judicial Watch, I should say, that show a connection between Washington, Cincinnati, and the IRS targeting of Tea Party groups. Your reaction?
You know, there's a pattern with this administration. You try to obfuscate and deny and delay, and then by the time there's information that comes out, they say it's old news, and it's really troubling. We need more aggressive congressional oversight, and this administration needs to stop trying to write law, and they're out of control.
I mean, it really took high-profile Tea Party-type candidates like Sarah Palin, Ted Cruz, and others to help you out. But other people didn't have the benefit, weren't the beneficiary of the Tea Party and how they've organized. That election's now in our rearview mirror. Do you think it's time for us to move on or drill down?
You know, what I find in Nebraska is that the folks here, they believe that the center of life is in Nebraska, not in Washington, D.C. And what Tea Party means to most of the folks across our state is they want more urgency out of Washington about the bigger things and staying out of the vast majority of life. So I think when you talk to people across the 93 counties in Nebraska, what they're looking for is a lot more serious return to constitutional principles, which is just the American idea that life is fundamentally lived in the private sector. I think that idea is a winning idea all across.
All right, it just hung up on me there. You got an idea what he's saying.
We got
like.
The idea.
Yeah, he's glib.
I think
he's glib.
You got some insights.
Yeah,
it's important.
Okay. All right.
Now, look, let's just do a couple of other points, right? We have limited time, huh? I want to point out a new book, which is not my book, and I don't know who the author is really at all, but it's a guy called, let's see if we find him here, Gareth Porter, and it's called Fabricated Crisis, and it just came out in the last couple
it's like
of weeks.
Synthetic Terror.
Well, Fabricated Crisis.
Yeah.
And his idea, this is an exhaustive study, according to what it's billed as. He has gone back and exhaustively read through all of the reports over the past 10, 15 years coming from the International Atomic Energy Agency. He's interviewed insiders from the U.S. intelligence community, State Department, and all this. And his finding is that the Iran nuclear bomb story is a complete myth from beginning to end.
Mm-hmm.
And that it was essentially concocted not by the Israelis even, but by the U.S. In the first person in the late 80s and the beginning of the 90s as a means of one of the many things that they threw out to try to keep the CIA and the military industrial people going after the collapse of the Soviet Union.
Boogeyman of the of du jour. All right, what do you think?
I think this is highly interesting. In other words, it's an attempt to review. Remember the national intelligence estimates, right? Mm-hmm. 2001, 2005, the NIEs said Iran has a nuclear program. The 2007 one, and you'll remember, that is when the power of the neocons was at an absolute low. 2007 NIE said no program. There is no Iranian nuclear program, although there was one before 2003. Now, I take the before 2003, that's a compromise. And they'll say, we're not going to say there never was one because that would cut out our neocon friends completely. But we're going to say there's none now, but there was one in the past. So this is very timely because today Ayatollah Khamenei made a really defiant speech, and it comes exactly as we're being told that at the P5 plus one nuclear talks, right, with Iran, which are supposed to come to something soon, the Western position has suddenly hardened and says, you've got to get rid of all 19,000 centrifuges, and the Iranians will never go along with that, nor should they. I think they have an absolute right to do this. This
absolute.
Is up to them.
Yep.
So I would think this is a very serious problem. It's like the stuff that Seymour Hersh did to show that the Syrian poison gas was either not done by Assad, that was one, or positively done by Turkey, Saudi Arabia, and other of these enemies. So that's that. Now, if anybody ever says to you, nobody wants boots on the ground in Ukraine, that's a lie. Jessica Matthews, the head of the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace, if you believe it, and a member of the Harvard Corporation, though she sits on the board of trustees of Harvard. Jessica Matthews, you know, well-known figure going back to the Carter administration. She's the daughter of the Barbara Tuchman, who wrote The Guns of August.
Oh, really?
It's very interesting. Barbara Tuchman, Guns of August, was used by Kennedy to try to stop the madmen, the Curtis LeMays and so forth, from attempting to turn the Cuban Missile Crisis into World War III.
Real close, yeah.
Now the daughter is saying she wants one U.S. brigade in Ukraine with 4 to 5 battalions coming from NATO countries. This would add up to about 2 brigades. This means one division. So she says, I want one division of forces in Ukraine up for maneuvers. She says, maneuvers, and you tell Putin our maneuvers will end as soon as your maneuvers end. But you see, this would be a horrendous escalation. So I would point to that, right? Don't let any neocon or humanitarian bomber ever say nobody, because it's not nobody. The other one is Anne-Marie Slaughter, and her plan, I think we might have mentioned it in the past, is you can't attack Putin in Ukraine because he's too strong there. Attack him in Syria, where he's much weaker. And I'm afraid, as time goes on, you get the idea that when she says Syria, she really means Syria and Iran, because there are, of course, Iranian forces, right? Hezbollah and Iranians in Syria.
Assad just won with 88.7% of the vote in Syria.
Right. And the irony there was that you can have a vote in Ukraine in the midst of combat, but in Syria you can't. And this skull and bones Secretary of State there, Kerry, a true degenerate example of
blatant imperialism.
He says it's a big zero. Now, the other one, can we say a few words about Bergdahl?
Go to it.
I think Bergdahl is a poor piece of human wreckage coming out of the Afghan war, whatever illusions he had when he went over there. He was obviously traumatized. I would say 9 chances out of 10, he's shell-shocked, PTSD,
he's
whatever you want to call it.
Sure.
And he is now being, I think, vilified. The interesting thing is, why, right? You have Republican hypocrites are trying to blame the deaths, right? The casualties, the people who got killed, service people, on Bergdahl. I would remind everybody, Ron Paul voted for the Afghanistan war. He voted for the authorization to use military force.
There's no question.
Which is the absolute fountainhead of all of this stuff.
Yep.
And of course, then Bush, Cheney, Wolfowitz, Pearl.
Do we negotiate with terrorists?
Ronald Reagan did. Yeah. We have Ronald Reagan. I remember it clearly. Comes on the television in 1986-87 and says, "Oh, I thought in my, you know, my water on the brain way that we weren't doing it, but now I find yes, we were negotiating and we were arming Iran. Arms for hostages was the bottom line. So who are they kidding?"
Now, all right, Rand Paul loves drones. We got to do this.
Rand Paul loves drones. Is that
Little Rand?
What it shows us is that the Republican Party, including Little Rand, are absolute incurable warmongers, and they will never change. Little Rand has exposed himself as an unprincipled adventurer and opportunist in this. Remember, he was cozying up to Cloven Bundy until Cloven had his racist outburst, and then Little Rand ran for the hills. And now on this one, Little Rand was saying, oh, Bergdahl, you know, welcome home, well done, thank you for your service. And then he flipped. Now he condemns Bergdahl, and, you know, he's, you know, if not a traitor, then something similar. And remember Rand Paul and the drones. Rand Paul now says drones should be sent to kill these 5 bearded characters from the Haqqani network. This is actually the Haqqani network, not even the normal Taliban.
Kind of a
remember, this
area.
Entire mythology, the idea that some lunatic with a beard in a cave in Afghanistan can kill you, that's the 9/11 myth.
course.
And many people who devoted many years to trying to debunk the 9/11, you know, demystify the 9/11 myth, our dear friends, the libertarians, they're now attacking Bergdahl, saying, oh, you caused these other people to get killed. It shows that there must never be, never, another Republican president. If you had had Romney, you'd now be at war with Syria, Russia, and most probably Iran also. How would you like that?
Hip deep in blood and guts.
And here, and this is now, Jeff, I think important in this Obama stuff, right? Obama made a sort of an angry speech today. But remember, when it comes to Ukraine, Obama has done almost nothing. Done almost nothing. He postures, he prevaricates, he evades.
Sent him some money, yeah.
He hasn't done anything. No, but don't send money to the warmongers who are attacking Obama, because whatever Obama is, not good, they're worse. The people now,
anyway.
Saxby Chambliss, let's take him, right? The Republican from Georgia. Remember how he got in, Jeff?
Yeah. No.
We had Senator Cleland, Senator Max Cleland of the 9/11 Commission.
Even
before that in 01 and 02, he had advanced doubts on the Afghan war and 9/11.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And Saxby Chambliss ran a campaign that Cleland was not a patriot. He was essentially a traitor. And this was a guy who left both legs. One arm on the battlefield there in Vietnam. So, again, my word is no more Republican presidents, never again. That is guaranteed dictatorship, guaranteed war. So, and if you don't like the Democrats, that leaves you with one hope. It's called the Tax Wall Street Party. So start it up in Nebraska. Please, give
TWP.
Us a hand.
TWP. This is a real party. TWP.
Yeah, sure.
All right.
I'm sorry. We should also add Randy Credico, who ran for mayor of New York last year on the Tax Wall Street Party ticket, is now running for governor of New York. He will probably be the only competition
for
the Wall Street puppet Cuomo on the Democratic ballot.
Yeah. Cuomo.
And this is, again, Tax Wall Street in this
familial dynasties. It's amazing.
Yeah, nepotists, right?
That's
and you see
that's
that again and again.
Yeah, always. All right, final quick comment, 30 seconds.
I would urge people to go see Dan for Nebraska. I think it's danfornebraska.com. And if you can help, right, there's signature gathering to be done. And similarly, look at Credico 2014. And get involved, right? If Tsipras can go from 4% to 30% and is about to take over the country, right, we should be able to do something here.
Those two
would be my principal choices.
Very good. All right, my friend, thank you.
Okay.
Talk to you soon.
See you soon, Jeff. Bye-bye.
Be well.